Very good evening to all brothers and sisters in the Dhamma. So today is Thursday, 26th of November 2020. We shall continue with our sharing on this book, The Essence of Sutra of Infinite Meaning, Teachings on the Adapted Verses of the Sutra of Infinite Meaning. We are at page 44. Just relax body and mind, then maintain a stable posture. We will have our usual half an hour awareness-based meditation. So I will off the light, then you can start your meditation. Always remember the four support: relax, maintain awareness for as long as you can, if possible, 24 hours. Then finally, trust your nature to do. Do not interfere with the thinking, the thought process. So first support, relax body and mind completely. Be at ease, free the mind. No need to think of anything. Thought arise, let it arise. Whatever that your mundane mind develop through contact, just aware, finish. Because the mundane mind is trapped within our physical body. So this mundane mind, which is the thinking mind, it is consciousness. It can make contact with the senses. So upon contact, consciousness arises. Then the seven universal together simultaneously arise. At the moment of your mental content that goes in based on your views, your opinion, and your conditioning. So the content of consciousness, when it goes in, it is very fast. So meditation is to develop the stability of awareness or mindfulness to be aware of this activity and movement so that you can observe clearly what is going on within our form and mind. First is establish mindfulness or heedfulness. That's why we relax body and mind completely at ease. Then maintain awareness, just aware. No need to know anything. Don't try to do anything or know anything, just aware. Whatever arises, aware, finish. Whether it's tactile consciousness, hearing consciousness, smell, taste, or thought consciousness, just aware. Aware means understand what is going on, finish. Then the mind will slowly settle down. As you are able to develop the ability to relax and let things be, your mundane mind or thinking mind, they will slow down. Then they will cease. When it ceases, the true mind will surface. The true mind is our awareness nature within, our true nature. That is the meditative mind, the mind that is just aware. Don't try to know, just stay with the awareness. When you stay in the awareness, there is no thought, no thinking, no arising or sankara activity. That's how you will realize your true mind, your silent mind. So you need to stabilize that. When you can stabilize that, you will develop good understanding. Then you can use that mind to meditate, to develop awakening and understanding. Hence, I have chosen to elaborate on these verses from the musical adaptation of the Sutra of Infinite Meaning in the hope of getting straight to the core of the Sutra's teaching. Through this explanation of the main principles of this Sutra, I hope to give everyone an opportunity to understand the underlying spirit of Jingshi Dhamma lineage. Yeah? This one belongs to Ciji, yeah? And the Ciji school of Buddhism. The adapted verses of the Sutra of Infinite Meaning were compiled by Mr. Wang Tuan Cheng, who distilled the central ideas of the Sutra and turned them into lyrics that could be set to music. Through either the sign language performance or the singable lyrics, this musical adaptation can help us hear, contemplate, practice, and uphold the Dhamma. To put it simply, it enables us to carry the Buddha in our hearts and live out the Dhamma. So this is like living the Dhamma in daily life. Or we manifest Dhamma in daily life. So to carry the Buddha in our heart and live out the Dhamma is to develop the ability to propagate the Dhamma or share the Dhamma with the world. Means make it a living reality. Dhamma become a living reality. Because when we have the Buddha in our heart, we can deliver the Dhamma. It's like the Buddha is the transformation body, Dhammakaya. The body that has the embodiment of the Dhamma. That's why it's called Dhammakaya. Kaya is the body, Dhamma body, that manifests the embodiment of the Dhamma. That's why it can teach the Dhamma. It can share the Dhamma with the world. Where does the ignorance and foolishness of ordinary human being or living being or people come from? So this is a very important question. They are created because the guiding light in our hearts has been covered and extinguished by our habitual tendencies. So this is one way to explain it. Ignorance arises when our true nature or our Buddha nature is being obscured or screened. So when that nature is being obscured, that's why they use this word, ignorant or foolishness or heedless behavior or living being. They arise because the guiding light, which is our pure nature in our heart, has been obscured. They say covered. And actually, it cannot be extinguished. He used the word extinguished by our habitual tendency. It's not extinguished. It's always there. But because you fail to realize that, you fail to understand that you have that beautiful nature, that's why you have been obscured from that nature. So you lost yourself. When you lost yourself, what happened? You deludedly entangle yourself and grasp onto the mundane mind that loses its ability to have that pure nature behind. Without that pure nature, you cannot develop the wisdom light. you cannot have that understanding. That's how ignorance arises, that pure nature when it's being clouded or obscured by the layer of mundane mind, it can lead to delusion, ignorance. So here the word extinguish may not be the correct word. Our heart has been covered or clouded or screened by this habitual tendency. Habitual tendency is the repeated action and behavior of this mundane thinking mind. Therefore, we first need to light the lamp in our heart. This one is just an analogy. The word is not the actual meaning. You cannot go and like get a you call it what? When you want to light a candle, you get a lighter or a match, and you try to light it. But our nature within is not a candle. You cannot go and light it. So the word that they use here is a figurative analogy. First, need to light the lamp in our light, in our heart. Actually, that one you don't need to light. You only need to realize it. Or like Huineng, you have to reach the state of no thought. Wu nian. When you can reach the state of no thought, means without the mundane mind, the thinking mind arising, then that true mind, that true nature will manifest, it will surface. Because the mundane mind actually caused you to lose your ability to realize that true nature. So because of that first thought of ignorance, from there, it started to lose its ability to return. So that first thought of ignorance that caused the evolution into samsara, that is the beginning of the primordial, what they call thinking. Yeah, we have to switch out the interference. Just now, I think Stephanie just locked in, then they didn't mute. So it's good for Kayamita to take note. When you log in, make sure you mute your mic. Otherwise, it can cause interference or distortion to the Zoom video recording. Okay. It's raining very heavily outside. I don't know whether it's raining on your side or not. But my side here, SS2, is raining very heavy. I think we are in the midst of a rainy season. So this particular analogy that she used, we need to be careful. It's just a figurative type of analogy. It's not the real true sense. So that nature within is all the time there. You no need to get a lighter to light it. No need. You only need to silence your mind. That's the reason why the meditation I teach you is to bring you directly to that silent mind, to that true nature. You just relax. Don't do anything. Maintain awareness to allow the mundane mind to settle down and cease. Then you will realize your true nature. Your true nature is your silent mind without the thought, without the sankhara. So that is your true mind. So all of meditation start with that because you have to reach the state of no thought. Wu nian. When you realize that, you will realize your true mind, your silent mind. So I will read on so that you understand. Even the light from a small lamp can allow us to peacefully walk the path to light. So this is the analogy. What she is trying to tell you is that light is the beginning of cultivation. So when you can realize that true mind, that silent mind, that awareness nature, then you will come to understand that you have two minds. One is the true mind that you use to develop awareness, to observe, to insight into phenomena, and to awaken, to meditate. You must meditate with that true mind, which is just an awareness nature. You cannot meditate with the mundane mind, with the thought process. Then it becomes thought-based meditation. Thought-based meditation has its limitation. It will limit you because the instrument you are using is thought. If you use thought to meditate, how can you realize the Dhamma that is beyond thought, beyond mind? The Dhamma which is akaliko, you can't. So all this understanding need to be developed. Then when you understand that there is an awareness nature in you that can allow you to observe thought, to observe sankhara, to observe the activity of the mundane mind, then to see and understand how creation comes to be, how the universal condition existence manifests. Means the conditioned world that arises dependent on condition, that one is very important. The understanding of that can awaken you. So the observation through the silent mind that developed the understanding of this paticca-samuppada teaching, or the law of dependent origination that the Buddha taught us, dwelling paticca-samuppada, dependent originating. So this teaching is very important. Sometimes they call it the dwelling. When you understand this paticca-samuppada, or law of dependent origination, you will understand mind. You will know how you function as a human being. Then you will develop all the penetrative wisdom and understanding to awaken. That's the reason why all meditation must start with sati, mindfulness. Sati or mindfulness is just an awareness before the knowing. That is your true mind. That is how you start. Everything arises from there. Just from there, that nature, everything come to be. The mundane mind is a product of that nature. From that nature, it manifests. Dependent on condition, it arises and it continues to exist, sustain itself. Then when condition cease to be, that phenomena cease to be, then it will condition new condition. That's why everything is dependent originating, dependent originating. Then from one nature, it manifests one living being. Then when there is countless, innumerous living being, it will create the condition world. Then it will manifest into infinite phenomena, infinite condition, leading to infinite teachings, infinite life forms, then infinite existence. That's why the conditional, or we call it the mundane existence, can be very massive, very phenomenal, and very, very immeasurable. That's why our universe, even scientists fail to understand what this universe is all about. It is so immense, so vast, and it's an expanding universe that is like without limit, without frontier. Even until today, scientists still cannot comprehend and understand how vast this universe is. They know that it's very immense, very, very extensive. But how extensive, they don't know. Well, from what they try to develop, the instrument that is available for them to probe, they even come out with very powerful telescope. Last time they call it the Hubble telescope, which is supposed to be the most powerful at that time. But now it seems other countries are developing equally powerful, or if not much more powerful telescope to actually probe the universe. Even with Hubble telescope, we actually managed to understand a lot more things. This Hubble telescope can actually see very, very far. And so far, they have probed until about 15 billion light years away. It's still unending. 15 billion light years away is from our planet Earth, where we see that thing that travel at the speed of light. It will take them 15 billion years later to reach that furthest frontier that they are able to probe. Just imagine 15 billion years traveling at the speed of light to reach there. By the time you reach there, what we saw on the Hubble telescope is already obsolete 15 billion years ago. So you don't know how the universe has changed. So it's really, really something very immense beyond our comprehension, unless you really have that omniscient nature of Samasambuddha. Even something that is 10, 15, or 100 light years away is already history. Whatever you saw on your telescope, because by the time you receive that light, it's already 10, 15, or 100 light years ago. So we are talking about the immensity which is never before understood. So they try to understand the unified theory, because all the various scientific theory, they manage to discover, penetrate, compound, but they fail to develop the ultimate unified theory so that they can understand the whole universe, movement and formation. It's like they use that word, they can understand the mind of God. They believe God created the universe. So the unified theory is supposed to develop that understanding. But what they found difficult to comprehend and penetrate is awareness. Consciousness, thought process, they have actually developed quite good understanding. But when it comes to that true mind, the pure mind, the awareness nature, which is beyond thought, beyond time, beyond the speed of light, which can travel beyond the speed of light, that one, they cannot develop the understanding. And that is the one that is the missing link. Because scientists has developed the understanding of electromagnetism, gravity, electricity, even sound wave theory. Also the what they call quantum physics, and many other what they call scientific understanding or theory, even the chemistry, the elements and all those things. But there are many more. The more they probe, the more they fail to understand. It's like when you try to probe the universe, the more you discover, the more you understand, the more you don't understand. Yes, you realize that the immensity, the extent of the universe is really beyond what we have at this moment, the technological understanding. There are so much more things that is happening in the universe. Even our solar system is not easy to comprehend. Each and every of this planet, some have so many moons, some don't have moon. Then their gravity, their characteristics, their atmosphere, and how they rotate on this axis like our planet Earth, that makes weather condition possible, life form possible. Certain planets, they don't have an atmosphere. They are destroyed by nature's forces. Then some, because of their distance from the sun, like Mercury, too hot, too near, very difficult to have proper life form. Unless the life form can survive that type of heat, UV light and intensity. Then ours, Earth, is the third planet. We are lucky. So the second planet is Venus. After Mercury is Venus, then planet Earth. Planet Earth is more conducive, not too far, not too near. So we managed to tap the UV light. That's why we have day and night, and we rotate on the axis. Whereas Mars, the fourth planet, is not so fortunate. Mars is more far, and it seems Mars may not have the atmosphere like us. So there are many things which we still have to probe. That's why now the human race is trying to break through the frontier of science and technology to develop their ability to comprehend more and more things. Hopefully there will be more and more breakthrough and we will understand more things. Okay, we'll go back to the sutra. Even the light from a small lamp can allow us to peacefully walk our path through life. So this one is the analogy that they give. When you can realize your true mind, your awareness nature, even the glimpse of it, the initial glimpse, is already very good, very powerful. But if you can stabilize that and use that to meditate and to live life, then you become beautiful. That's why it's mentioned by the author, even the light from a small lamp is the initial lamp that light that thing, means your initial ability to have a glimpse of that nature. It is already very useful. It can allow us to peacefully walk our path through life so that we are not deluded by the mundane mind, the thinking mind, the heedless thinking mind, the mind that has the avijja behind, ignorant, the mind that is not awakened. So that one brings about evil consequences, leads to suffering and misery. Then a single light can obliterate 1,000 years of darkness, which is very true. That first glimpse of that nature actually can transform you. can make you realize that there is another nature within, that is beyond thought, beyond mind, that is peaceful, tranquil, and still, without sankhara activity, without emotion, without agitation, without any movement. That's why they call it the unconditioned, 不生不灭. But it has the ability to be aware that that nature is a nature, it's not a being, it's not somebody inside there. No. Every life form, every living thing, including human being, we have that nature. That's why in the teaching, they always call it the oneness nature. Sometimes they use the word original nature, 本性, our true nature, 自性. 本性 is original nature, 自性 is our true nature. Then 本来的面目, our original nature. Then the oneness nature. Then sometimes they also call it the unconditioned. When you realize the unconditioned means you realize what Nibbana is. Nibbana is the cessation of form and mind when everything ceases, including the five aggregates of form and mind. Even the pure awareness nature ceases. Means that pure awareness that come out, the first one that come out from that oneness nature, even that one also cease, then only you can return to that true nature, the original nature, the oneness nature, to be one with everything. So scientists call it the singularity, means from that singularity, everything comes to be. That's why some call it the source of all things. So these are the various words which religion give to describe this nature that they can't understand. But certain teaching misunderstood this nature. They thought it is something that they can cling on to. They call it the ultimate Atman or the ultimate self, the true self. So they thought once they realized that, that is what they are. No. For those who have gone through that thing, they will know the cessation of form and mind, the realization of Nibbana. That's why the Buddha in his teaching also described it very clearly. He said, Sabbe Sankara Anicchang, Sabbe Sankara Dukkang. All of Sankara is impermanent, Anicchang. All of Sankara lead to suffering when you attach and cling, when you want things your way, which is not nature's way. Then finally, he never says Sabbe Sankara Anatta. He used another word, sabbe dhamma anatta. Dhamma means, dhamma covers the conditioned dhamma and the unconditioned dhamma. So both the conditioned dhamma and the unconditioned dhamma, they are both anatta. Anatta means non-self, not a permanent unchanging entity, doesn't belong to anybody, nobody can own it. Hold on to it. No, there is no such thing. So that understanding is very important. That's why the Buddha says, Sabbe Dhamma Anatta. So this is the teaching. For those who can meditate and stabilize that nature and finally develop the wisdom and the awakening to finally realize Nibbana, they will understand what that thing is. So in the Mahayana teaching, they also have a saying, Ming Xing Xian Xing. When you realize that bright mind, or the true mind, you realize your nature, your awareness nature, your true nature. Your mind must be bright, clear. There must be clarity. Then you realize that nature. Then you will go to the cessation. That nature is not a conditioned state. It's not something that you can hold on to, grasp on to, cling on to, and call it the great Atman or the me or the I. So this one is to make clear what that nature is. Okay, we go back to the teaching. Okay, a single light can obliterate 1,000 years of darkness. This is very true. When you can realize that nature, it actually awakens you. And the darkness is to denote ignorance. When there is ignorance, delusion, your nature is being clouded. So it's like you cannot see. Everything is like in darkness. So you may be deluded for very long, 1,000 years of darkness. That's why a single light can overcome 1,000 years of darkness. A spark of wisdom can eliminate 10,000 generations of ignorance. So a single light transforming into a spark of wisdom already can have that potency to manifest that type of wisdom. That's why it can eliminate 10,000 generations of ignorance. So this is a figurative analogy. Yeah? If we can ignite the light of wisdom within ourselves, even though our minds may have been shrouded in darkness for thousands of years, they will be illuminated. This is very true. Yeah? You can be deluded and ignorant for eons and eons and eons. But the moment you awaken, you can illuminate that nature. Then that nature, which is bright and clear, that has the understanding, that one, the wisdom will be connected to your form and mind. Because it is through realizing that nature that you can develop the wisdom. And when the wisdom is connected to the form and mind that come to this segmented life that you arise. For our case, is this human form. That segmented life, that form and mind, this life, mine, you call Brother Teo. Yours, you have your own. So when you awaken, that wisdom which is connected to this form and mind, this one will enable the form and mind not to be deluded by the phenomenal world. Then with that wisdom connected, there will be no more avijja, no more ignorance. That's why you can say the form and mind is enlightened. But that form and mind is not real, not me, not you. Yeah, that one is dependent, originating, condition arising, causal phenomena. You can say it is a karmically conditioned from our karmic nature, a vehicle and a tool for us to come. So we call it that segmented life for the existence. Our present one is this human existence. Yeah. So this one, when you understand, then you will not be deluded. You will not go and believe that there is a being who is enlightened, there is an atta, then you won't cling, you won't grasp. Otherwise, you can be trapped. So I will read on. If we can ignite the light of wisdom within ourselves, even though our minds have been shrouded in darkness for thousands of years, they will be illuminated. I hope that together starting now, we can enter the teaching in the adapted verse of the Sutra of Infinite Meaning with sincere reverence. Stay close to the Buddha's heart and live out the Dhamma. And this is most beautiful. So the author really wish that we can do it together, sincerely. Okay, now we move on to the next chapter. Chapter 1. This is the actual chapter 1, virtue. Okay. So this is the sayings. A single light can obliterate 1,000 years of darkness. A spark of wisdom can eliminate 10,000 generations of ignorance. Praise the Buddha's inconceivable virtue. He is a great teacher of sentient beings. I think it's a poem. What is that note for? Good. This is a footnote. I read to you the footnote. Yeah, there is a footnote there. In this book, all phrases in this form were written by Dhamma Master Chen Yen. Oh, no wonder. When she delivered the lecture on the adapted verses, the content of this teaching were drawn from other Buddhist scriptures as well as her own unique understanding and experiences. Now, this is very useful. They aim to explain the principles in the Sutra of Infinite Meaning so that the audience can easily understand the important message of the Sutra text and carry out the teaching in their daily living. So this one, the note is very useful. So all the phrases in that form were written by Dhamma Master Chen Yen. She is the author of this book. So when she delivered the lectures on the adapted verse, these are her writing. So this one, I think, is mainly her poems. Phrases in this form. Okay, we go back. Yes. So the title in the beginning is all by Dhamma Master Chen Yen. Chen Yen Fasi. There is a dark room that was once bright. And this refers to our true nature. Then how it falls and get obscured. Then when you cling on to the mundane mind, the heedless thinking mind with the ignorant, then you start to move away from that pure nature. That's how you get yourself lost and your nature has been screened or clouded, but has not been lit for thousands of years. If someone kindles a light, it will dispel the darkness and completely illuminate the room. So this analogy is quite good. The world is like this dark room. The Buddha Dharma is the bright light. The Buddha taught us that everyone possesses that Buddha nature. This one very important. Each and every one of us living being, we have our Buddha nature within. It is only because it has been covered by ignorance or clouded, screened by ignorance, that the light of wisdom within us has been dimmed. But no matter how long the light of the Buddha nature or Buddha Dharma has been obscured, as long as there are those who aspire to go among people and teach the Buddha Dharma to help them break free from their worldly delusion, we will be able to uncover our intrinsic pure nature. And this is your true nature. Intrinsic is original, pure nature. Even though we have been trapped in cyclic existence in the sixth realm for a long time, as long as we can reflect on our own nature or true nature, we will awaken and our intrinsic nature will manifest. If living beings can help kindle each other, others' light one by one, kindle each other's lights, one by one. The light was spread, and the inner wisdom in every one of us was shine brightly. When this happened, our existential world or planet will be very beautiful. The whole of existence will be like a paradise. There are three mirrors on the wall. On the wall of the elevator of the Ciji Culture and Communication Center in Guangdu. When taking the elevator, we can see the mirrors reflecting each other. If someone stands in the middle and put her palm together, there will be countless reflection of this person with her palm sincerely pressed together. Whatever action she takes, the same action will be reflected in all the mirror. There is also a light in the elevator, as the light is also being reflected in the mirror. Its image is multiplied, and innumerable images of the light appear clearly. The scientific principle that is demonstrated here is similar to the Buddha Dharma. It has been more than 2,500 years since the Buddha expounded the Dhamma, but it is still being transmitted between people in the present as the light of the Buddha's heart illuminates and is reflected in our own heart. Our inner light can also illuminate and be reflected in the hearts of others. Thus, the Buddha Dharma can be passed on continuously. So a better word will be transmitted on continuously. So this is something that living beings need to understand. No matter how ignorant a person is, if they have the affinity and the condition to meet up with the triple gem, they can awaken, because the triple gem holds the teaching. That's the reason why the Buddha said we must take refuge. There is no refuge safe except the triple gem. It is only within the triple gem, the Buddha Dhamma and the Sangha, that you can find this teaching. Yeah. The triple gem are the embodiment of the first gem is the Sammasambuddha. So since the Sammasambuddha has perfected its nature, it will have the teaching where it is the embodiment of perfect wisdom and virtue, born of the cultivation, the 10 perfections. And from him, the teaching, the Buddha Dharma, was discovered and shared with the world, transmitted to humanity, to living beings. So the second gem is the Dhamma. So the Dhamma is the teaching, the Buddha's teaching. So this one is what Dhamma is. So when you have the Dhamma, you will have the wisdom. Your nature will awaken. Then the third gem is the Sangha, the enlightened disciple of the Buddhas. Since they are enlightened disciple, they definitely has the Dhamma. That's why when you take refuge with the triple gem, it means you cultivate affinity with this Buddha Dhamma and the Sangha. And because of our affinity, we will be able to have condition to realize the Dhamma, to have the condition to receive this teaching. So this is the reason why the Buddha strongly recommend all cultivators to take refuge. The only refuge safe is the triple gem. So you must take refuge in the Buddha, Dhamma, and the Sangha. And we repeat it 3 times. Second time is Dutiyampi. Buddhang saranang gacchami. Then at the time, tatiyampi, Buddhang saranang gacchami. To the Buddha, I sincerely, with faith, go for refuge. To the Dhamma, I sincerely, with the faith, go for refuge. And to the Aryan Sangha too, I sincerely, with the faith, go for refuge. Then for the second time, we take refuge. For the third time, we take refuge. This shows the seriousness of refuge, the importance of creating this affinity. Yeah, when we start to affirm and sincerely with faith, when we take this refuge, we cultivate great affinity with the Triple Gem. Taking refuge means we pay respect and surrender our nature. We have faith. We are sincere to walk this way, to cultivate this teaching. That's why we take refuge. Refuge safe. When you go to somebody or some place for refuge, means that sanctuary, that place can actually protect you, save you from falling into ignorant delusion. So taking refuge has its great meaning. The most important reason is to develop and cultivate that affinity with the Triple Gem so that it is strongly planted within our Bohi mind. So that the seed of Bohi can nurture beautifully because of that affinity. Wherever you arise, the Triple Gem, wherever there is the Triple Gem, you will have affinity with it. That's why you can be born with higher chance during the Buddha Sasana, where that is the time the Buddha arises. The teaching is there and the enlightened disciples are there. So refuge in the Triple Gem can guarantee connection and affinity to the Buddha, Dhamma, and the Sangha. That's why your probability of taking birth during the Buddha Sasana is very high. And you have to make aspiration like the Bodhisattva vow that I have developed for you, the yellow card. We not only take refuge with the Buddha, Dhamma, and the Sangha, we also make aspiration, you remember? Cultivate strong affinity with great beings, not only one enlightened Sammasambuddha, with all the great beings. We develop the faith, the what they call the strong aspiration and the sincerity to go this way, then we should have gratitude and respect towards them, cultivate great affinity with them, and we seek their protection, guidance, and blessing life after life whenever we arise. Means whenever you choose to come or you have to come, depending on your position, whether you are strong, confirm Bodhisattva, or you are just on the path beginning to walk this way. So sometimes when it's not strong, stable, then you may take the vow, but it will not be stable. So you have to wait till it stabilizes. So initially, before you become a full-fledged Bodhisattva, due to your vows, your aspiration, even though you are not a Bodhisattva yet, so your rebirth consciousness, they will still be beautiful. Means, although you cannot choose to come, you have to come through karmic conditioning, but because of your understanding, because of your sincerity, your faith, your aspiration or whatever you do, that's why you will still have that understanding and the condition, it will still manifest. That's why I use the word, whether you choose to come or you have to come. Have to come means certain birth, you got no choice because you haven't stabilized your bodhisattva way. But once your bodhisattva way is stabilized, then you can choose to come. That's why you can decide the timing, the condition behind. So your understanding can set for the condition, the causes and condition. Otherwise, it will just come with the pure mind. Pure mind means you are already on the bodhisattva way. You can have the pure mind to actually condition rebirth consciousness because of your vow, the basic vow, the four basic vow of bodhisattva. So that one will create the love and compassion for the pure mind to arise. Then because your karmic nature is there, so it can give rise to a form and mind, a segmented life for you to arise. But that one, you cannot choose. Where your nature has not stabilized to actually let you have the ability to decide or to choose, you will still come. But you will be different too, except that your nature will not be so powerful and have the ability to decide many things, to choose to come in different civilization, to have parents and all those things. A lot of this you may not be able to decide because you don't have the full understanding or a very firm understanding of the nature's law or adhittana, how to make that type of aspiration to have those conditions. And also you need parami. You need to have very strong parami, perfection, for you to have that type of nature. Your nature has to be very stable and very unique. So all this, as you walk the path, you will learn, you will develop. And hopefully, you will understand. The Avatamsaka Sutta states, if one wishes to completely understand all Buddhas of the past, present, and future, one should contemplate that all things in the universe are created by the mind. Whether in the past, present, or future, all Buddhas attain enlightenment in the human realm. So this one is a very powerful statement. Whether in the past, present, or future, all Buddhas attain enlightenment in the human realm. So that shows the importance of the human realm. As the Buddha engaged in spiritual practices in this world, he demonstrated many different methods. The purpose of each method was to guide and transform sentient beings. Everything begins in the mind. That's why the Buddha always quote this, mind is the forerunner of all things, mind is chief. When mind arises, all things arise. So however many afflictions exist in the minds of sentient beings, the Buddha has to give just as many teachings. All Dhamma arise from one. One can give rise to all Dhamma. This is the essence of the Sutra of Infinite Meaning. The one Dhamma is the Dhamma of the mind. In truth, ignorant fundamentally does not exist in our mind. Only when the six sense organs come into contact with the external six sense object or sense data, do the afflictions of greed, hatred, and delusion, ignorance, and doubt arise. If we can constantly reflect on our own mind, and awaken our pure intrinsic nature to eliminate our affliction, then we need not be afraid or ignorant, clouding our mind. The Buddha nature is not difficult to learn. All of the sutra and discourses teach us the same principle, to treat each other with a genuine and pure heart and see through and eradicate past ignorance and affliction to restore the purity of the mind. So we go to note 5 first. Let's see what they write. Must be the 5 sense organs. Ah, yes. So these are the 5 sense organs, or the basis. They call it the liu gen. In Mandarin, it's called liu gen. That's why they say 6 roots. Liu gen, actually, is the 6 sense basis. Or they call it the sense organ. Gen. So we have the eye, the ear, the nose, the mouth is actually the tongue, then the body and mind, tactile, body is tactile, and mind is our brain, the mundane mind. Then not 6 is the sense data, must be, not 6, their respective sense data, they call it the 6 dust, liu chen, the 6 sense data or 6 dust. They call it dust because it dilute you. form, sight and sound. So form is external form, mental form. Then you have the sound, vibration. Then you have smell, taste, touch or tactile, and thought process. Okay. And then I will explain the thing a bit. Okay, stay here. So if you look at this paragraph, what she has explained is quite good, but you have to understand it in more detail, then it will help you. The one Dhamma is the Dhamma of mind. So from mind, we start. So this mind is initially the true mind. Then from the true mind, the true nature, the mundane mind manifests. That's why the mundane mind is a byproduct of the true mind. You remember the 4 circles in the Heart Sutra that I explained to you how living being manifests. From the source, the oneness. The first one to come out is the pure awareness. That is your true mind, your pure awareness. Then after that, from that pure awareness, we have what we call the phenomenal world, of consciousness, which is basically the mundane mind. Just now that one. So you see, the first one is the oneness nature. You can call it the Buddha nature or the true nature or whatever. Then the first thing that come out is the pure awareness. This pure awareness is your silent mind, is your true mind, this pure awareness. So this one is your true mind. From here, it manifests. This is the first one. Then after that, the byproduct of it is the mundane mind. When this mundane mind starts to stir or react to sense experience through the 6 sense door due to ignorance, avijja, and delusion, then it created the mundane mind. So this mundane mind is the manifestation. That's why mind make our day. So you have to understand how it happened. Then from there, the mundane mind create mundane consciousness. And this mundane consciousness create the external phenomenal world or external manifestation of mind created via mental consciousness. So the external manifestation of mind creates the phenomenal world of form and consciousness. Then to meditate is to understand this and realize how we come, how we fall, how we come out. Then we have to return to the source, to return to our true nature, beyond nature. So to return, we need to develop the wisdom, the awakening, the understanding. Then when we develop the wisdom and understand that the conditioned world is all dependent, originating, conditioned, arising, causal phenomenon, it has the universal characteristics of impermanent suffering state or nature and the non-self or empty nature. And when you see clearly the unreality of form and unreality of mind, then this external form and consciousness will have no power over us. Means they will collapse in front of our wisdom. So the phenomenal world of consciousness and external form, they will collapse. Once they collapse, it will cease. Because we know that they are unreal, impermanent. You attach and cling, give meaning, lead to suffering. And because they are impermanent, it's not a permanent unchanging entity. He know you, he know me. No reality. Non-self. Empty. Everything is just dependent, originating, follow condition, mighty nature rolling by, no reality. So once that penetrative understanding and wisdom arise, it ceases to have power over you, then the whole phenomenal world of form and consciousness will collapse in front of you. Then you can live life beautifully. You don't have to worry about life. You don't have to be deluded by what you see, what you hear, what you smell, what you taste, what you tactile feel and think. Then the sixth sense become non-grasping. Once it become non-grasping, you become beautiful. Then that form and mind will not have suffering, will not have misery, delusion, because it doesn't grasp, it doesn't hold, it just echo and flow. Then it just live life to the fullest. You can experience all of the pristine beauties and wonders of life that the phenomenal world can actually give rise to. So once you return all this back to the mundane mind realizes itself and ceases. Then what happens? When it ceases, you will realize the true mind, the pure awareness. That's how you return. So from the external phenomenal world of consciousness, you return it to the mundane mind. Where is the mundane mind that created it? Then from the mundane mind, you cease, then it will return to its pure nature, the true nature. That's why the true mind is very important. So when you have the true mind, you can be aware of the movement of the mundane mind, the conditioned arising mind. Then the sixth sense door, because this mundane mind is trapped within the physical form that has the sense basis. So just now the sense basis that the author mentioned, they are the six sense basis and the six sense data. Upon contact with consciousness, they give rise to the six type of corresponding sense door consciousness. That's how the phenomenal world of consciousness and form arise. So when you see with the true mind, with the pure awareness in meditative state, how they arise, you will understand how delusion arise, how it condition you to stir and react to external sense data. Then you input the wrong content of consciousness through ignorance, through avijja. So wrong thought condition, misery, suffering. That's why all of your fear, worry, anxiety, sorrow, and lamentation, your suffering, your affliction, your misery, they are conditioned by your wrong thoughts. And what are wrong thoughts? Thought that has the evil roots of greed, hatred, and delusion. That's why they are called wrong thought. So the mundane mind that doesn't have wisdom will react and stir and create wrong thought that condition the evil roots to condition your suffering, misery, and affliction. That's why when we understand what constitutes wrong thought, we will understand life. Wrong thought are thought that has the evil root that will condition our fear, our worry, our anxiety, our sorrow and lamentation, our insecurity, our scars of memory, our whatever emotional negativity, doubts and fear. So all these are wrong thought. Then the Buddha teaches how to straighten our views, how to actually develop the opposite right thought, leading to right speech, right action, and right living, or right communication. So this is what Noble Eightfold Path is all about. So this is what meditation is all about. Through awareness, through mindfulness, we develop the stability of it. And when we are heedful throughout the day, we will be able to root out ignorance, straighten our view, develop the initial wisdom. Yoniso manasikara. So all this understanding will surface. So when we have this initial wisdom, yoniso manasikara, then we will not stir our mind. We will not react to sense experience anymore. And because of that, we become more calm, more peaceful. That's how we realize the true mind. When you don't stir and react and create, the mundane mind cease to be. That's how you have more and more moment of peacefulness, more and more moment of space between thought. That's how you develop tranquility of mind, stillness of mind, and the silent mind. So your true mind manifests. That's how you develop the step 5, sati sampajana. Mindfulness and clear comprehension can be developed, the daily mindfulness. So you need the initial wisdom, step 4, and go to step 5. Then after that, you will have sense restraint. Because with sati sampajana, you can actually develop sense restraint because you are sensitive, you are mindful, and the initial wisdom prompts you, and you know what they are. That's why they have no power over you. Then you will not arise the evil root. That's why there is sense restraint. You will not react and stir your mind into ignorance or avidya or self-delusion. You will not attach and cling on to things exactly like what the Sutra of Innumerable Meaning is trying to teach you, except they didn't describe the process, the training, the cultivation. That's why in this sharing, I will have to explain all this so that you understand. Okay, we go back to the notes, and I will finish it all. So after this six endor, if we can constantly reflect on our own mind and awaken our pure intrinsic nature to eliminate our affliction. This one they didn't explain, understand? They just describe. Then who can understand? If I don't describe to you how it's been done, you cannot understand. You don't know how to cultivate. So this one, take care of the explanation part. So you have to constantly reflect, contemplate, and inquire. This is the second turning wisdom. On how your own mind actually function, react to sense experience, or say. And then, if we can constantly reflect, contemplate on this mind's movement and awaken, means based on all the 10 steps of the Abhijja Sutta, you can develop the wisdom, the initial wisdom, and awaken. Once you awaken, you can realize your pure intrinsic nature, means your true nature. Then you can straighten your view to eliminate all affliction. Then you need not be afraid of ignorance clouding your mind, because you already had the wisdom, you straighten your view. So ignorance has no power over you. The Buddha Dharma is not difficult to learn, which is very true. When you have the understanding, it's not difficult to learn. And all of the sutras and discourse teaches us the same principle. To treat each other with a genuine and pure heart, means free of the evil root, and see through and eradicate past ignorance and affliction, means after you become mindful and aware, you can see your own delusion, your own ignorance, how you react to sense experience through your sakkayaditti, self-delusion, and how you entangle yourself and develop the affliction and the suffering. To restore the purity of your mind, which is true, means to straighten your view, to root out all this. Okay, good, we stop here. Because it's 10 o'clock already, 10:02. So we will stop here and we will have our second session, which is meditation reporting, followed by sharing of the Dhamma, Dhamma in daily life. Or you can ask me whatever question you have. It's a Q&A session, come meditation reporting and sharing. So we will open up.
Hello.
Hello. Who is it?
Hey, good evening, Stephanie.
Stephanie, yes.
Good evening.
Yes.
Oh, brother. Thank you, everybody, for the previous sharing.
That time when we call you, I think you were sleeping.
I was dozed off. And then suddenly I realized my name.
Now you can actually replace that session.
I realize with Dharma, life is so beautiful.
Very good.
In Mandarin, you feel very tasu.
Yeah.
That means anything happen, you follow noble path. You don't panic. You don't, things seem to flow very well.
Very good.
And how to say, every morning I wake up with a lot of gratitude.
That is very good.
A lot of joy.
And
thank you, Bratil, for helping me to find this place. My neighbors are also good, very good.
Yeah, Yun-chan was the one that actually paved the way for you all. She's the one that actually introduced you to me, I remember.
After
she introduced you, you decide to give us a treat. Yong Tau Fu, I remember. We went to somewhere. The other side of somewhere near that place we seldom go on. Yeah. I think it's
Subangtu.
No, not Subangtu. That time was over this side. You haven't shifted to Subang yet that time. That time was over this side. Mayang there go in one.
Mayang.
New area. That area is a new. You remember the Yong Tau Fu you used?
Champui Hong used to stay.
That place. What is the name already? I forgot already. Mayang Mas or what?
Mayang Mas, like Glomax.
Yeah,
I think Glomax
area. I still remember. That was about 2006, I think, 14 years ago. Time flies. You should thank Yun Chan. Yun Chan, now I was told. President of Gotama Vihara.
This place, they supported Gotami Vihara.
She called me just now and to thank our Kayamita. We decided to donate 2,000 ringgit for that.
Vihara.
So she was full of joy.
I followed her to the place once.
Sadhu.
They supported those that nuns traveling, so they need accommodation.
Okay. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Then they gave some, they got, I mean, some living meditation, I mean, living, how to say, daily life meditation, to the resident there nearby.
Oh, okay, okay. The center is in Cheras, isn't it?
Cheras, Cheras.
Mm, yeah.
Quite a distant away. I followed her once there.
Oh, okay, okay. I think quite near to Chin Hao's place. Eh?
Yeah, quite near to Chin Hao's place.
Yeah. So the SAMS confinement center also beyond 28, also somewhere nearby. Huh? But Cheras is...
Oh, SAMS.
It's near Chin Hao's house, the beyond 28, the confinement center. It's a very beautiful confinement center, very well done up.
Design.
Yeah. Oh. So if people find a need, you can contact Sam. He can show you around and let you understand.
It's a very good concept, actually.
Because it's very well done. His very good.
I heard from Gumon, he said, it's like a five-star hotel.
It's like fully equipped with everything, food and lodging, and you can have your internet, everything there. And it's really like a very luxurious resort home. And 5 meals a day, very good meal for confinement lady.
Actually, it relieves a lot of family. Confinement lady is very costly.
The food they cook, that kind of confinement food that they cook, a lot of variety, very good choice and mix. Especially the ginger chicken and all those things. We went and tasted the food. It was really good. So for people who have a need, can go and look it up. Beyond 28, you Google confinement center, Cheras KL. And then you can find all the details there.
But even with the MCO, I find we are really, with all the modern technology, we are really blessed. Without going out, we can attend Dharma class. We can learn so many things. We are really blessed.
In fact, my nephew also told me, he texted me today, this morning. He said, he called me Kuku. He received this Prolexus AGM. He said this year is in a video conference, Zoom. So he asked me whether he can attend or not. I said, sure, you can. You are a shareholder. So I said, wow, this is interesting. He said, every time, because it's in Batu Pahat, I think Kuang area, the head office. So every year, the AGM, they don't get to attend. But this year, he intend to take leave to attend, to lock in. Yeah, he told me the company has some compulsory leave for them to take. Yeah, you don't take also, it will be burned. So he's planning to take that.
Really, no need to go. A lot of times you can...
Then she can... He said he can learn to vote. He hasn't voted before. He wants to vote for the dividend to be paid. It was very cute of him to mention all those things. So what he said is very true. Sometimes too far away and we don't have the time to attend AGM, we can actually use this. Then yesterday I received a video from Brother Wong Tam Kyong. I think the top girl Zoom interview with all the press people, also very good, very impressive.
How is Wong Tam Kyong, brother?
I think he's okay.
Good to hear that. We visited him how long ago?
Quite some time back. He's still in contact with me. He sent me some good WhatsApp message and articles.
Also very happy to hear Eric doing so well.
Actually, Brother Wong, he has his pension now. Not much, but a few thousand, I think. Two thousand plus a month. That one come from Sokso, I was told. I don't know whether it was Sokso or what.
You mean with Brother this Mr. Brother Wong Kam Kyung, he resigned already?
No. I don't know whether he resigned already or not, but his condition.
Oh, Sokso will give him some
get him the compensation, the pensionable type of compensation. Oh. Just to pay people for disability or whatever. So his case qualifying, you know, it seems.
But he also do a lot of dana.
Yeah, a lot of charity.
Blood donation.
Then he do a lot of charity. Every time he get receive bonus or money from somewhere,
he will share with all the Kalyanita.
10% of whatever he has. He's very generous.
Yeah.
Then he likes Dhamma.
I still remember when I was with Vipassana every year.
That's how
I take charge of the bus to KKB, and he will help me as conductor.
That's how it all started last time when Yuan Chan invited me to start teaching at Vipassana Center. That is where I met him and get to know him, because it was Bun Chai, I think, that. Asked him to attend. So he was very cute. He said, initially, he was reluctant to come. He said, but Bun Chai tried to convince him. He said, you come. He said, Red Teo is very good. And he said, what he teach? Four Noble Truths. So he taught Four Noble Truths, nothing else. But there was one day, I think he finally make it. He said, okay. He dropped by. Then after he listened to that talk, he invited me for supper, no, after the talk. So we went for supper. And during supper, we talked. Then after that, I think on a few occasions, he also invited me for supper and dinner. Then what happened was, after I think 2 months or so, he started to tell me why he find me interesting. He said, just from this Four Noble Truths, he thought Four Noble Truths was nothing, very simple. But the way I explain it, the tree turning and all those things, it becomes so different. No?
And apply it to daily life.
And he saw that whole thing so beautiful. That's why he that time asked me a lot of questions. But when I answer him that time, I don't think he was ready to develop the understanding. Because his conditioning of the teaching that he received was different. So many things at that time, I don't think he can comprehend and understand. But later on, I think he continued to do a lot of dana.
He's very generous and very helpful. He helped in many society. I think
Correct. Naranda also. He also support Naranda. Then Breakfield. Also, I think Sentu. And Vipassana Society. He also support. He very close to Bun Chai. They all.
Time flies. Long time.
You continue with your sharing, you can report meditation or ask questions or share Dhamma and daily life. You continue,
I will meditate. Normally, I'll meditate early morning when I wake up, and I find it's a good way to start the day.
We can hear you.
If nothing happened, normally we feel that we understood. But sometimes certain hinges, then you only realize, oh no, I'm not there. then you have to use a Dhamma. I say Dhamma contemplate. Everything happened for a reason. So you have to settle down and become and see what's going wrong. I normally do
that. Is a good way.
And no negativity. And
very good understanding.
Clear mind to see what you can do out of it.
Yeah. So that reflection and contemplation is very important. Yeah, this is how you actually develop the cultivation. Like you say, the best check is when you encounter real affliction or happening in daily life. Then you realize you are not there yet because you still react. It's normal to react, to stir your mind, because initially not stable yet. The uni soap manasakara not stable yet, and it cannot come out immediately to prompt you. Then you feel it. You cannot.
I always remember, brother, you always say, if you have you feel anger, all this is your evil root.
Whenever you are unhappy and not peaceful,
our egoic mind,
That's why the best check is whenever you are unhappy and not peaceful, the evil roots are there. Wrong thought has arisen. That is the best check. Easier.
Yeah.
Because when we are unhappy, it means what? We react to something. We want things our way, which is not
clinging.
Then you are not peaceful. It will disturb you. It make you like worry, like have doubt. Then you are not peaceful. Then it will create sankhara activity. Then you try to think. You try to rationalize. Then you try to dialogue with yourself. Sometimes you were in the mind through the sankhara. You chatter, say, how can
I? Sometimes you go to your dream.
If you attach and cling, it will release through your dreams, the subconscious release. So it will complain, how can that guy do that to me? The world is so unfair. So these are all the mundane delusion, the ignorance, the sakayadity, the wrong thought. Because this one does not bring about harmony, peace, understanding, and clarity. The first thing to do is, like just now you mentioned, not stable yet, but you can do it. To accept whatever arises, where there is a reality, then resolve it amicably. We are following Noble Eightfold Path. That is the Dhamma way. You need to reflect, contemplate, and do that more often. Whatever happened, if you realize your mind has reacted, stir, that it has made you unhappy and the lack of peace, then you know the error roots are there. That's why you mentioned you have to reflect on it, contemplate, then try to resolve it following the Dhamma way, following Noble Eightfold Path. That is a good start. Very, very good start. So every time you recall that, that is cultivation. That's how you will stabilize the understanding. And when you stabilize that unisoul manasikara become more stable, then the next time when you experience the same situation or sense experience, it will prompt you straight away. Then you will not stir your mind and react anymore. Then you can be at peace. And later on when you reflect, like what I shared with you all, the world is the world. People are just the way they are. Deluded people do deluded things. Angry people do angry things. Then you realize you can accept them for what they are. You can be at peace more and more. More and more. So that type of mind that you have developed through an understanding, you should develop it more and more until very stable, until you can accept all situations, all type of people with all type of character. Then you have developed the understanding. Then when something happens spontaneously, you no longer react and get angry anymore. The first thing that come out is, through your awareness, you will apologize first. Sorry if I caused you any misunderstanding or accident or whatever. You become very different. You are very humble, full of humility, full of consideration. Then you are willing to forgive. others and move on, then you will be able to apply Noble Eightfold Path, smile, thank people with all the right thought, right speech, right action, and the right way to actually develop harmony, understanding, and give people joy. All this will fall into place. That's why you need to develop this training. And this will help you. Other Kayamita also, when they hear this, this is how you cultivate and stabilize the understanding. Okay, Stephanie, can I understand?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Pradhyam.
Anything else?
Recently we our neighborhood they have a WhatsApp group to take care of our security. They say, so it's quite helpful. They also have strict rule. They say, okay, no WhatsApp after 11, solely only on issues, neighborhood issue. No, you cannot use it to like promote your things. All this is very good. So recently there's some break in some of the places, so they alert everybody watch out for them, for the motorbike or for the car, for the all this. So there was one day this lady put, there's a rider, watching there. Then one guy, I think human nature, when it they take it very sensitive, we say, what's wrong with the rider? You know, I'm also a rider. Sometimes people's their mind, they graft on, I'm also a rider, what's wrong with rider?
That's why the administrator must have the skill to actually administer this thing so that you can be resolved amicably. Because you have WhatsApp group or chat group, they tend to develop this type of argument and misunderstanding, especially if that group is too big or quite new. So when the rules are not clear, then it happened. Yeah, last time within our chat group in the early days, the Kayamita website also has
when they bring in some political.
Then we resolve it immediately. Suyan did a good job. After that, Suyan text that person separately, independently, and explain to them on how this My Kayamita WhatsApp group was established to develop that type of harmony, mainly for Dharma understanding and sometimes important information to update ourselves, then sometimes to protect ourselves. Some of this useful sharing and information we can allow, but most of the time it's for Dhamma.
Besides this, actually it's quite good. They even they need help for
sometimes for aircon, repair or
repair.
We have a big
very helpful
Kayamita who has the support, then you can actually contact them. Sometimes you can actually put it, then they will come back to you. I think most of them send direct to Suyan, if I'm not wrong, where he seems to have a lot of contact.
Suyan. Very resourceful.
Then in the early days, I remember the WhatsApp group from my hometown schoolmates, then later on university mate. The initial stages, certain occasion, there was some misunderstanding. Then they argue, like you mentioned, they argue. Why like that? I don't agree. Then they sometimes too eager to promote certain ideology and all those things. It become like flooded with that type of thing and video. Then the administrator has to pull that person out and talk to that person in a very nice manner. Then only they withdraw that type of comments. But there was one case. After cautioning him, he still repeat, no.
Oh.
Then after that, we had a first meeting among ourselves, the initial, the administrator together with a few of us that originated this idea of having this WhatsApp group to connect back all our classmates, and we had a general discussion. We set up a separate WhatsApp group, and we asked for consensus on what to do with him. So we say, give him another chance. Three times. Three times also, he abused that thing.
Wow. So eventually, kick him out.
So we decide very easy, in a very polite way. We tell the administrator, since we have spoken to you, discussed with you, and given you three opportunity to actually understand our reason for setting up this one, we are very sorry to take this action. Miss, for the time being, temporarily, we will take you out. But if you, after about 1 month or 2 months or 3 months, decide to abide by this, then you can text the administrator to say, okay, from now onward, you are willing to abide by the rules and change. And then only we will add you back. So he became like very, I don't think he's happier, but he like starts to understand why people take him out. Well, he is very strong in his views and opinion of things, the ideology side and all those things. So finally, I think they let him come back, but under a different WhatsApp group. Yeah, we have another one, our school anniversary. So the administrator didn't allow him to go into the main one, but allow him to go into the one that we set up temporary for how many years? 1960. Oh, 60 year anniversary. 60 year anniversary since primary school. 1960. Yeah. I was in standard one. 1960.
No, that's
60 years anniversary. So that was a very
really long. Well, since primary, I brought you your
primary school. Yeah, our classmates all we are actually long time classmates.
I have different school, different primary one school, secondary one school, college.
I was same school. But primary school, there are only two main schools that goes into that college. That college is a very prestigious, the best English school in Kedah. So when we enter college, it's either you are from Iskandar Primary School or Tunku Halim Primary School.
The band very famous one, isn't it?
Yeah. I was the pioneer in the school band.
Yeah.
I played the side drum. We were the pioneer, first batch. That time I was in Form 5. Form 5.
So I remember that.
The band. Yeah, the band was very famous. And very beautiful band. Okay, I think it's already 10:30, Stephanie?
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Good night. Thank you.
So let us rejoice. Sadhu. Sadhu. Sadhu.
Hi Stephanie and to all.
Hi, long time no see.
But still, I have been very I miss a lot of your classes actually.
Okay.
Either that or I join in very late.
Mm-hmm.
There was the last session. I came back after everything. I took my bath. I was so tired. I didn't even. Didn't even join the class.
No problem. Just let things be.
My mind was like overworked.
Yeah. Understandable, don't worry.
Yeah. very much like what Stephanie says, I think without the Dharma, I think my life would be so much more difficult.
Because
find it very difficult to deal with certain situations.
Correct.
But somehow I managed
that. Yeah, because you have the understanding. Yeah.
Yeah. especially when situations, you know, that side situations
of yeah.
Changes.
Correct.
Then unexpected things will come up.
Yes.
That's
this
when
is
it really tests you to
correct.
See how much of how's your understanding.
Yeah,
of the
yeah. Oh,
and
that's
especially when you have to deal with difficult
yeah,
things.
Yeah, 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 yeah. Very good. These are the things we can share, huh?
Yeah.
Because everybody encounter life differently. Like earlier on, Manyuan encounter life differently. Then Pocheng, the progress and all those things. Even Stephanie, huh? Elsie, Alicia, Pamasri, or even Adeline, huh? Even Christina. Everybody experience life differently, and Tammy also, Karen also.
Yeah,
but with the Dhamma, they have better understanding.
Very,
yeah, continue, yeah. Yeah, PJ, continue.
Actually, what I want to say was I'm very amazed with how Eric's understanding.
Oh, very good, huh? Oh,
sadhu. There's one time, there's one time when we met up in BM to meet up with Ming Chen Sifu's place.
Oh, okay.
And I always remember what he told me. Don't believe your mind.
Yeah.
So I think to him, that's why that's how he overcome his fears and all this.
Yeah.
And, his one sentence that's very, I think, very important is, he says he understands his mind.
Yeah, that one very important.
Yeah, he understands his mind. I go like, wow.
Because he only understands one very important thing: what constitute wrong thought. That one actually transformed him and took him out of 18 years of depression. Then he become completely
wrong
different.
Wrong
thoughts. Yes. He only understand that because he came to the Thursday class. You remember, Suyan, there?
Yeah.
I keep on repeating the wrong thought thing. Scars of memory, insecurity, your fear, worry, anxiety, the accumulated memory, good and bad. Yeah, that is what memory is all about. So accumulated experiences in life become your memory. So this memory is the source of wrong thought, because thought is respond to memory. So when you attach and cling to all these unhappy moments, like your scars of memory, your what they call insecurity, unhappiness, deep resentment, your fear, your worry, your phobia, all this trigger wrong thought and make you miserable, suffer, afflicted. Then you're
I think very importantly is they condition your views of everything.
Yeah, then you become unhappy. You react.
And we react, yes. The way we react to things is because of our conditioning.
Yeah, habitual tendency, your conditioning. Then he told me a lot of things, how he perceived negatively about a lot of things in life, like everything not right, blame everybody, including blaming himself. Then blame everybody. Then finally he become like so afflicted and so depressed. Then he starts to have this funny thinking. He said, maybe all these people who say I'm useless, I'm what and what and what, is true. He start to believe those words, then he become more miserable, more afflicted. Then he become very depressed. But he managed to overcome it after attending the class, 2-3 sessions only.
Yes, then one of those really super speed.
Yeah, then he encouraged Kotlun Dey all to come, you remember? He brought along a lot of friends. Because last time they had one group who has problem with life. All of them have problems. So they attend the motivational course and try to find answer and solution to their problem. Even Kotlun also went through a lot of tough life experiences. involving his parents, his father, his brother, and construction site, you know. His one is worse than yours. Yours is only ID, huh? His one
yeah,
is the
only temporary few months.
His one is the whole construction site, you know. Oh.
Yeah.
And I tell you, his one is really go to war on. But he did it so well after
yeah, he
had the understanding.
Yeah, he did it very well, the way he handled
yeah.
the situation.
Yes.
And the way he can, overturn his...
Yeah, turn things around.
Yeah. Mm.
And motivate the staff, you know, and tell the staff, if you don't change, your future is already set. You got no chance of coming out. But you actually has the potential. That's why he told them, why not you learn this? You change. Oh, then that staff got promoted now from a supervisor to the head of safety officer now. Another company actually headhunted him. He's one of his blue eye boy. His right hand man, he say.
So beautiful.
Yeah, he was able to transform him. And all the site people become so different now, according to Colin. He said last time all complain only one. Come to site, complain this, complain that, then no harmony, nothing. Well, now they come and talk to Kotlun and tell Kotlun, can we do overtime? They want to do overtime, no. They say given this rate of progress, we are too slow, we say. So we need to move fast. Well, all this idea come from them, no. From the weak team that people reject, all his men, people don't want to know. Very difficult to count. Even the project manager also have to change. It was a very difficult project. But when he went in, he actually took over a very messy project and he managed to turn it around through Dhamma. Nothing else. He applied Noble Eightfold Path. He has faith.
Very amazing.
He has faith. Then he asked for forgiveness. He persevered. Then he applied Noble Eightfold Path. Then he talked to people nicely. He developed harmony. Then he looked at people and how to motivate them, change them for the better. Then the whole site become different, become one of the best site. Even the management also came to know. Then he make a lot of aspiration, pure wish. Then the aspiration come true. That's why his mind stayed very good. Problem all resolved, like everything fall into place. He himself was very amazed. He said the Dhamma is really beautiful. Then instead of creating misunderstanding, enmity,
yeah.
Everybody becomes so positive after that. Because they saw the leadership in him. And he is kind, he is sincere, he is helpful. And he trained people. He gave people opportunity, chance. That's how he do it. That's why Dhamma can be applied very beautifully. And from his sharing, my nature has a lot of joy, really. So, pity.
Yeah, he's doing very well. He's doing very well.
So, in Mandarin, they say, jia yu, add oil. You know what is add oil?
Yeah.
Be diligent.
No, I need that.
Ka yao, ka yao. Jia yu. So, that is very good. Sadhu. Anything else?
Thank you, Bertio.
Yeah, thank you. Sadhu. Let us rejoice,
Then we end.
Yeah. Sadhu. Sadhu. Sadhu.